stuff? Okay, thank you for coming. Initially, I didn't intend to make any slides at all because I intended to have some small brainstorming session with a few interested people. I want to talk about how secure is our Debian desktop. This means for users who are using day-to-day applications on their, for example, the laptop or the desktop machine. I want to outline my security budget for what I'm intending to solve. What is the problem I see that we currently have. First of all, from time to time, we all have to, or in the past, it comes to occasion where you have to run untrusted software. Like, do you really trust Accurate, this Adobe Reader? You are perhaps aware that it is by default able to run JavaScript and connect other websites to the internet, but there are use cases where you really have to use that. For example, like filling out formulas in PDF files or something. And you can imagine various other applications where you really need to run proprietary applications where you don't know the source, but you don't know exactly what it is. And you run it anyway in one environment or the other one. Or even if you restrict us to use just free software, I think we all have used IceWeasel or Firefox at some point. And if you look at the security history, it's not really a secure software, but we still use it. We know that there are malicious websites doing all kinds of weird things with JavaScript, so many people prefer to just turn off JavaScript, but seriously, does it work for day-to-day use? I think not. Or think about buffer overflows in, for example, media players. We still want to watch video from somewhere, and we still run unsecure media players because, of course, they are unsecure, but we live with that. What are the problems with running unsecure software? Well, malicious code running on your desktop can, for example, delete or manipulate your files. Mm-hmm. Or think about confidential data, like you store bank accounts in your home directory, credentials for bank accounts, or your GPG key. If you run Firefox on your laptop, you essentially grant Firefox the right to access, transmit, delete, whatever with your GPG key. Think about that. I think that's a serious problem. Generally, nothing happens because Firefox generally won't open your GPG key, but potentially it has the right to do this. And I think this is potentially dangerous. Now, I want to move your view to other operating systems which are more popular, which are quite popular. There we have software suites of all various kinds. They call it personal firewalls, where you can restrict the software to where you can intercept the software when it calls to the internet, and you get some sort of pop-up or other notification. What help? An application called Microsoft Internet Explorer is trying to access the internet to this or that website. Do you grant or do you want to disallow this? There are other kinds of sandboxes, software suites available on Windows. There are various kinds of virus and Trojan scanners and other auditing tools for Windows. Now let's shift back to Debian. What do we have here? There are some commercial products like this Panda antivirus on firewall. Have you seen that before? How that works? That's quite similar to a personal firewall, which I explained to you. So if you get notification like Adobe Reader is trying to call home to this IP address, but that's commercial. There are really various all kinds of other virus scanners available for Linux or Debian, therefore. I think I don't need to count them. There is some free software for in this year area of interest which I'm talking about, like ClamAV. I think there are other virus scanners besides ClamAV, but that's perhaps the most popular one. I'm not sure if there's any software for sandboxing or free software for this personal firewall. Does anyone know here some software which can be used for sandboxes?
In some way, you can consider IC Linux
right.
As a sandboxing system.
Well, I think that the most common way to sandbox application is to virtualize. So if you run, if you install a Debian in a QEMU environment and run only untrusted software there, then I think you can reach some kind of, you can be quite confident that nothing bad will happen to, for example, your GPG key or something.
You can also run
vServers.
Sorry?
Like run vServers.
vServers, that's, but that's another kind, that's not virtualization, that's isolation, but
yeah.
It comes to the same point, right?
It depends on how much you want to get protected, but you
yes.
can also just basically run your potentially malicious software in a separate, in another user account.
Yes, you can separate with different user accounts.
Yes,
but that's also a pain in the ass.
You can't really say that to users to do that.
Wait,
yes.
It could be, it wouldn't be so difficult to have a separate user account and do some kind of sudo and
if it was transparent and easy to do, but I don't think at the moment it would be
with the XNest thing on.
Mm-hmm. I think that's an approach Microsoft is doing with Lister, running Internet Explorer in an other, less privileged security context.
Yeah.
Trying to remove all the everyone having to be administrator to do everything.
Yes, for example, yes. Right, so virtualization could be one approach, but I think we all agree that's not really what we want here. Well, and you mentioned C Linux before. Yes, there are a couple of security frameworks in the Linux world. You already mentioned C Linux. It's a very intensive and broad approach. It requires you to label your complete file system, to have this this time rule enforcement depending on the role you are and depending on which label the binary you have to execute. The policy itself in C Linux is implemented by the reference policy, and well, it's too much to explain C Linux in detail in this talk. I just want to mention C Linux exists there. We have heard a talk with Manoj at the beginning of this week. I hope you have heard that. An alternative or another way approach to do this is UpArmor. UpArmor wants to compete with C Linux without having to relabel your complete file system because they rely on file system locations. So they say, okay, you want to run the binary user bin Firefox, so it has this set of rules applied to them. I just looked up before the comparison page C Linux and UpArmor on novel.com. Obviously biased, and I just copied out design with usability in mind. Well, sure, they make different constraints and assumptions more easy, so they can have easier rules. What you cannot do with UpArmor, for example, is to have the same binary running in different security contexts. So you can't have a Firefox which is able to access your more secure cookies than another one. It's not possible with UpArmor. There are also some other less known security frameworks. Who of you knows SysTrace? And heard everyone from that? You know? It's very common in Net and OpenBSD because it has been properly integrated in the system. You can think about it like a firewall for system calls. You start an application in a SysTrace environment where you apply a set of rules which system calls are allowed with which parameters and so on. For example, you can apply a policy to the open system call and then match a regular expression to see what kinds of files the application is able to open and which not and with which mode and whatever. This is SysTrace. Is this? It's VARC, but I think it matches a bit more system, not?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
It seems like a kludgy system to me. So.
Sorry?
It always seems like kind of a kludgy system to me when you're trying to do security based on filing matching and argument matching.
Well, it's not only a file name.
Yeah.
It's just that you can also apply security policies, for example, to the connect system call,
yeah.
which allows you to implement
which IP addresses you connect to.
Right.
Yeah.
Or if you apply it to everything, you can have something like a personal firewall, if applied correctly. And there's a follow-up. Has anyone heard of before of RSBAC? Anyone? That's really interesting, because from what I've seen from the website, it seems to be an impressive project, but it's rather just a framework and not a ready-to-use solution. They provide you to install in your system modules they call ADF, access control decision facility, and access control enforcement facilities, and you can install several of these decision facilities in various places of the Linux kernel, which handles things, all kinds of things like IPC, file access, network access, whatever, and with this you can also implement different security policies. I wanted this to be a brainstorming of these are four security frameworks which we would be able to use. I explained to you the problems which we currently have, and I think we all agree that they are real problems which we really should find some ways how to deal with them. And I'm open for suggestion how one of these four, or maybe someone gets up with another idea, how we can see perhaps a roadmap to approach how to solve this problem. Yes, that was my last slide for you. What we were thinking about, Stefan Fritsch and me, we are currently developing some top-down approach by thinking what we understand with a security policy, and the next steps to map our understanding of a security policy to one or more of these frameworks. Currently, it looks like it boils down to SysTrace for reasons that are not interesting yet. But we wanted to hear your opinions. Do you think these security facilities are, or which of these security facilities are usable to solve the problems we commonly have on the desktop at all?
I can't think that in 5 years' time, or maybe two, we could live without something like I have a SIG image in mind, but whatever it is, which enforce security based in the context of what the application is doing. I guess everybody is more or less aware of SIG Linux. And we also have to have some stuff that also can detect some kind of malware, call it virus or whatever.
With SL Linux?
No, not with SL Linux, but it's as an extra. I don't like the antivirus word, it's not meaningful, but some stuff that can detect that you have downloaded something which is not. It's probably going to have a strange behavior. Yeah, kind of antivirus. SNX is, to me, probably one of the best candidates. SysTrace is, I see it as a cheaper way to implement some Linux stuff, maybe easier to move our system and maybe to modify.
I'll say I see Linux. I'm not really using much, but quite a way to go. I think probably more people need to use it and so they can improve the policies and stuff.
The problem with Linux is, of course, that it's very complex to get a policy that works for the user. So, would you think that it's feasible to just to leave most things running unconstrained in just the web browser and some special applications that are constrained by SVNs? Is this a valid approach for the beginning? Or
this
would
is
this just a slightly harder problem?
In fact, this is the approach the reference policy is doing. And the reference policy is basically the only usable, real usable, in fact usable policy for Linux, which that's why it's reference policy targeted, is the full name.
Yeah, but it's only for hosting services, it's not. Even not for web browsers.
It could include
But different users would have different requirements for the web browser, maybe, and so they would have different policies for the different users. Mm-hmm. So I think that's quite a complex task to design a policy that would.
There's no easy way currently to switch between things, I think, is one of the problems. But it's also obviously a security issue, because if it's easy to switch between them, then you're not secure.
A switch between what exactly?
What you're allowing it to do.
Mm-hmm. You mean applying new policies?
Yeah.
Applying new policy to a running or to a new process?
Yeah.
Okay.
Basically, currently you have to reboot, don't you? If you're
with SELinux, you can install new policy modules, the reference policy is modular, and you can load and unload security modules, which are part of the policy you're implementing at runtime, just like you can do with kernel modules. The problem with this is that with SELinux, this is a privileged operation, so you have to be root to install a new security policy in the kernel. What would be really slick was if the user would be able to constrain himself from saying, I'm starting ActoRead now and I want this particular instance of ActoRead to be not able to contact any network. Because from UnoPDF I don't see why it should be able to contact the network.
Yeah, so if you, when you're about to start a program, you can pick that you want to make it, say, more enforced than normal.
This
probably
is
probably the way to do it, rather than you go, I want this to be completely open, because then that would be whatever Trojan virus, etc. would do, if it managed to get onto the machine, to be able to talk back or install things or whatever.
Having something like, this is an interesting thing I'm going to run, just get it restricted in some way.
Right.
It would be nice to have a feature.
And this is in fact doable with SysTrace. Surprisingly, yes, it is, because you cannot run SysTrace within SysTrace. That was a limitation, right? So if you have the compute desktop running already in SysTrace, you cannot run.
Can you not have a worker?
Yes, you.
Which then would apply some extra constraints.
Right, you can perhaps trap the SysTrace system call, compare the new rules with the older rules, define some metric which defines this rule more or less strict, and if it is less strict, then allow it, otherwise deny it. I did some research on SysTrace on Debian. There used to be a package called kernel patch SysTrace along with the SysTrace tools. It has been removed since some time from Debian because the old maintainer lost interest in it and just often had it removed from the Debian archive. There is one upstream guy who still ports it to Linux, so it's waiting to be packaged by someone who actually uses it. So it could be really an option, but we need to package it. There are packages, ready-to-use packages for Synonyms made by Manoj. I think there are AppArmor packages for Debian. I know that Ubuntu guys are working on AppArmor, so that should be easy to get this into Debian if it isn't already. System needs to be packaged in RSPAC. The upstream guys are providing some Debian packages, but it seems nobody has used it so far. And I really hope that we had someone who could tell me about that, but it seems to be no one here.
I think it is for the desktop, it's got to be as simple as possible. I don't think people are going to be running wrappers and stuff around things. I think the way that, yeah, like saying the worst, the most dangerous thing is like web browser, like email and streaming media and stuff. It just, I think it's good defaults to not let the web browser go to GPT key and stuff like that.
Yes, but
doing the same things.
Yes, this is basically what we are trying to solve.
Yeah.
How?
It should be default, it shouldn't be a choice, or you should have to opt out of it or something. By default, it should do.
But if it causes problems, people won't want it.
Yeah.
To turn it off.
Yeah.
I think, to answer your question, I think we can't expect to have a SELinux strict policy.
Yeah.
In the next few years, so we must get through some what they call targeted. Say, as we do today, this daemon can do this and this action, and maybe extend this to user.
Which is insane things, you know. Like you wouldn't want. Would a user want to upload your GPT key using web browser?
And say Firefox just don't go to password file and to this one and to.
It would be better to say it can go into this rather than you having to keep adding
your
passwords.
Right.
Yeah.
But the idea of targeting
the idea of targeting
is to have transition and say we can't do straight today, so just try to have something better.
And just gradually add.
Yeah.
Because people are going to get upset if they can't save a file anywhere they want. So for instance, I guess for every location, that's what you're upset.
But some of that's compromises
that
you just get used to. As long as you can see that this, there's this benefit, and so, okay, you move the file afterwards, but you're much more secure.
So the basic idea is to start with a small set of rules, which are supposed to not break too much, and then gradually improve the rules.
I guess
is that what you had in mind before?
Obviously, there's only one to give. To assume it's the only way to get someday to a strict police enforcement.
I think the best thing is if people run it and then they can see what actions their web browser wants to do and allow it. And then hopefully all normal things people want to do will be allowed. And then things that malware wants to do won't be allowed.
I think one of the problems with things like SELinux is everyone's sort of half thinking, well, this is really complicated, there's not that many major problems at the moment, I can live without it. So there's partly a PR side to, I think, this.
Mm-hmm.
And going, look, it's easy to install, it doesn't cause you any problems, just do this.
And in fact, security frameworks are designed to cause problems. Because you want to restrict.
Yes,
so this is...
Well, that's part of the problem, so...
If you don't restrict people from doing what they don't want to do anyway, it's not a problem.
But
many applications have bugs and access files they don't really need, or whatever. So there will be always false positive warnings or weird problems.
Just an adult, I'm studying migration to Linux for my company,
mm-hmm.
I work for. And security has actually been one of the issues we've looked at, obviously. And then we were a little won't say surprised, but most people will know the Windows-style group policy stuff. You've got an Active Directory environment. Does anybody know some sort of equivalent for Linux-based operating systems? For Linux operating systems? I mean, some central management, because I completely agree that something you want to have on a desktop should be as easy as possible for the end user. However, you may come across some situations in which management should be done centrally. And basically that was one of the things we didn't really find stuff about.
I think you have a very good point here, but can you please elaborate on the requirements you have? I just heard centralized now.
Yep.
What other requirements are there? Or what do you want to restrict, or what do you understand here on the security policy?
I think with Windows, you've got very fine-grained control. You can turn off things on people's desktops.
Absolutely.
You can stop them accessing the command line. You can control the menu. It's slightly different.
Yeah, it's not entirely... there's two things about those group policy things. One part is more configuration based. You can switch of icons and stuff. Mm-hmm. But some other parts is also security related, and it's actually for the security related bits. Yeah.
Okay.
Are you meaning like running programs, or are you meaning?
For example, yes. So what we're doing now, right now, is giving through such policies access to particular programs on the workstations.
Which has changed from historical, if it was there, you can run it.
I suppose the thing you definitely have to get, got to get working on a single machine first, where you can administer it.
That's for sure.
Okay, so these policy you set in Windows don't restrict programs from doing certain actions, but they restrict from the user from doing any applications.
That's it.
Right.
Okay. So we could do something with groups and stuff.
Okay. That's a difference.
Basically, we would like to go in much more detail. Mm-hmm. Some centrally managed SA Linux stuff, on which we can really go more fine-grained and say, like, this program can access this file in this situation.
You can do it with SA Linux, yeah.
So basically, you would like C Linux, but have it managed centrally.
Mm-hmm. You'd have to write it yourself. You could do it without that, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Some people, have you heard about CF Engine?
Yes.
Yes.
Some people use FAI or Puppet, I don't know this one,
mm-hmm.
Which allow you to centrally manage and push whatever you want to all your distributed computers.
And to certain ones as well, you don't have to apply it to
Yeah, you can, yeah.
You've got
you
different
have
groups,
classes of machines.
So that would be the way to go.
Well, CF Engine is a tool to distribute a configuration policy, whatever that means.
You still have to decide on the policy and find ways of actually implementing the policy.
And it's basically system configuration.
Mm-hmm.
It again doesn't allow you to restrict programs from doing certain things.
But you could stop user, you could have, if you used ACLs rather than just basic file permissions, you could do it for users allowed to run the programs, but that's maybe a bit complicated.
Mm-hmm. This goes to this Windows approach that you have one centralized service which sets basic Unix file permissions to restrict users or groups to things.
Does CF Engine allow you to use ACLs, or is it just basic file permissions? I don't know.
Both.
It
does both.
You could presumably use it to deploy a SE Linux policy as well that would contain.
Yes.
If you wrote the policy first.
Yeah.
Since you are allowed to execute shell commands and parse files and edit files, you basically allowed to do anything, including.
So you need a special policy for CF Engine as well.
Key. I know there is a security framework in Xorg being in place or being hacked on. Can you give me a small overview of what this is usable for today?
Well,
course it's not usable for anything because it's just a framework.
Yes.
The basic architecture is structured very similar to SCNX, where you have applied policy to those activities and you restrict access to resources within the X server. So you have the default access control in the X server is once you're in, you get it and get at everything. So there's no inter-process restrictions whatsoever. And the XACE security framework allows you to implement CLinux style policies inside the X server to restrict access to various properties. So you can restrict the ability to do cut and paste between applications, or you can restrict the visibility of other applications from one another. So, you know, essentially partition your work environment into multiple discrete logical sets. There's a set of applications that are granted additional privileges, like the window manager has the ability to manipulate all of the windows on the screen. this grows out of the SC Linux work and historical X security framework, which had fairly sophisticated policy and fairly sophisticated access control frameworks, but not any really competent policies.
And how does it relate to SL Linux? Does it use the same syntax and the same mechanisms, or is it completely different?
It uses the same semantics. I'm not exactly the, because the objects are different, it can't really show it's quite precisely the same files or anything, but the basic concepts are very similar. I'm not exactly sure how where the policy is stored, or how it's loaded, or how it's managed at this point. It's only visible to me in terms of access restrictions, so I've actually tried to use it. And it's being done by Amy Walsh, who's at the NSA.
Mm-hmm. In what stage is it? Is it early?
I don't know. He worked on it before he got his security clearance at the NSA quite heavily for a year and a half or so, and then he went off and disappeared for a couple of years. Now he's back doing more work on it. I don't know what the state is. I don't know if it's usable or if it's ready for use or if it's much of work. I have investigated to see where it is at this point.
So it's mainly developed by the NSA?
Yeah.
There is a publicly available framework, but no policy, like the reference policy.
Yeah, I don't even know if he has a reference policy. So it's interesting to find out. Mm-hmm.
What's the policy of the hardware?
It provides some level of security. It would be very interesting to try to run Firefox without the ability to do cut and paste, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not sure at this point, because a lot of inter-process communication happens outside of the X environment.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure what the added security X issue at this point. A lot of the communication is now done via DBus.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's certainly another, unfortunately, because these frameworks don't talk about DBus security. How do we integrate these? I mean, DBus has its own security framework, where you have particular processes and particular users, particular groups are allowed access to different resources in the system. So how does the DBus, how do all these different services, which now have this wide variety of different security frameworks in place, how do we manage them and provide any kind of unified information about what your current security policy is? A bunch of disparate mechanisms right now. So. None of this stuff talks about what we do with X or DBus or HAL information or access to devices, all this kind of stuff.
It's a few months ago now, but I remember reading a scientific paper from the NSA talking about how to apply CLinux to something as weird as the gconf database. I think you've read the paper as well.
No, I've heard
Okay. explaining and describing how to design and implement a user space object manager, I think he calls it.
Great.
And he's applying the concepts
read the type and role and look at this subject to object things to gconf. And he's labeling the gconf keys by duplicating the complete gconf tree to subtree prefix by C Linux and then the name of the thing. There he stores the security labels.
Yep.
And then each time an application, well, in order to access the gconf, you have to use a well-defined interface. And it's
but it's, there's not a database engine behind the enforcement policy.
Right, and the paper therefore proposes, because currently gconf is commonly used with Orbit, with a Corba interface. And in the paper he proposes to move the to drop that and just switch to dbus. Because from the dbus side you can implement this user space object manager more easily to enforce C Linux rules on access to the gconf database. And that's what the paper is basically about. So it seems to be at least in theory solved somehow.
Well, I mean, everybody seems to be focusing on getting to being able to use SC Linux style access control for all these different databases, which seems like a good. We have the, it sounds like moving dbus in the same way. It seems like it's pushing us in the SC Linux direction away from these other alternate frameworks. Because it seems more, the concepts in SC Linux seem more generally applicable across a wide domain of different databases. But we had an old access control mechanism in X that was just a disaster, so. Actually compartmented both workstations, so you had basically two domains. You had the secure trusted applications and untrusted applications.
Mm-hmm.
Trusted applications could do anything, and untrusted applications couldn't do anything. And if you remember the adventures of the SSH, where they turned that on, all of a sudden your X applications.
What?
Booting yourself? Yeah. Nice guys.
This sounds quite similar to what we are using currently in Unix by separating a root account, which can do anything, and user account, which can do a restricted set of actions.
Yeah, except because everybody had run as root for so long, there was a bunch of extensions in the system that weren't engaged in the security framework. And so all of a sudden, half of your extensions no longer worked for SSH access applications. Made all the anything coming in over SSH was labeled untrusted.
Mm.
So when the render extension stopped working. It's pretty broken.
Okay. How does the audience, or how do you feel now? What can we do from the Debian side to or which approach would be most feasible to have a secure desktop as I defined it in my talk before? Which framework or which way would you suggest to be the most feasible to go there?
I think the other distributions are already showing that SELX is the direction of pushing things in, because it does provide enough semantics and flexibility to incorporate it in a wide variety of different systems. Mm-hmm. Doesn't seem like, I mean, there just isn't any community support for these other mechanisms. They have shown themselves to be significantly more competent or easy to configure.
Mm-hmm. Other opinions? No, I just agree with that.
Okay. Well, in fact, I agree with you as well, but I wanted to hear. Because Ian Jackson seems to object quite strongly to SC Linux for being a framework which introduces a very complex set of rules on something which should be simple.
Well, if it's too simple, then I don't think it's powerful.
I don't agree with him. I just say his argument.
Yeah, I don't think his argument is wrong though. SE Linux is for all intents and purposes today impossible for the average user to get here. And to say that we need to ship policy frameworks for SE Linux, I mean, that just seems crazy. But we haven't come up with a better mechanism yet. So it'd be nice if it was simpler.
Either simpler or just providing it so that it works.
Yeah. Well, if the user can't understand what it, how it's configured, then the user is never going to know that it's secure. And they'll act like accidental configuration changes that will make it insecure again. And I don't know how the SE Linux community is addressing that particular issue. It makes some sense in the server environment where you can expect there to be a competent and knowledgeable system in there. But on a desktop, seems like we have a long ways to go before SE Linux can be understood and configured by the average user.
Well, there's the two parts there. There's like corporate desktops, and then there's home users.
Right.
So maybe they're
very
corporate desktops.
They're very difficult to separate.
Yeah.
Because the corporate desktop at this point is mutated randomly by the corporate user. As much as corporations would like to lock down their desktops, the users who manage to work around those restrictions on a regular basis.
It obviously depends if they've got root of the machine, in which case all bets are off. But
if you can physically touch the machine, you have access to it.
Yeah, ish.
What?
Essential use.
Yeah.
But then you can, if someone's actually booting off removable media and stuff and pulling the BIOS battery out, you can then take policy, workplace policy things rather than computer policy against them. That point.
Well,
because
sure.
They're obviously violating things if they're doing that.
Right. In our student computer pool, it's the users have physical access to the machines, but they are told to not switch the, it off, to not reboot it because it has a password. And while in fact users could just take it offline and do various things about it, but we have cameras and a big stick if people are doing that.
Yeah, or if you have security cables through machines, meaning that you have to actually like take crowbar to pry the case apart, which is enough deterrent, I would say, for most things.
Yeah, well, like in a copy in a student environment, makes it, that works quite well, but in a corporate environment, you have less control over people than you would think. In any case, if the user doesn't understand the policy, independent of whether they're intentionally mutating or not, they don't know what they are secure against. So they don't know what the system is providing them. So in the worst case, you just frustrate them. And I guess in the worst case, they violate security policies. But even in the best case, they're just frustrated when you use the system. It's certainly not something we want to encourage them to feel.
What problems I see with SE Linux is, at this point, I don't see how SE Linux is able to help me with implementing some sort of personal firewall. This means to supervise applications, what they are actually doing, and asking me if they are allowed to do this. So this feedback mechanism.
Well, does SE Linux not provide any mechanism for redirecting requests? If you get a connect request that to it, if you have an application trying to make a network access, SE Linux doesn't really seem to provide any ways saying either you can either say yes or no. It doesn't seem to provide a mechanism for saying wait, let me check.
I haven't seen that yet, but that would be very helpful in this case.
Yeah, I think that's. Although, then again, we have the endless pop-ups on Windows.
Yeah.
I think I heard of some software that actually, regarding the network aspect of some kind of firewall, some guy who actually made something which works with IP tables and with GUI, just ask what.
Pandas.
Pandas.
Yes, Pandas providing this.
So free implementation.
Ah, there's also I think Firestore is called as GPL, yes. I think there's another GPL implementation, now that you say that.
Well, how does that allow you to pause a connection? Give you time to answer?
I think there is an IP tables user space target where you can redirect an packet to user space and then let a user space privilege daemon contact the user session debus and make it pop up something. I think there is even a GPL application for that. But it's that in there it's really restricted to networking connections, which is a good thing in basic, but I was rather looking for a more
I think there are the two distinct things. There's network and there's files. I'm not sure if there's anything, there's an easy way of actually tying these two together apart from just having a program that does two different things.
My point of view is, if we really, in long term, if we really want to address security problem of desktop, I don't think we can rely on any user interaction to enforce security, because we know how users are. The first time they're being asked, maybe they're going to worry what's pop-up assuming they understand, they might give a sensible answer. The fifth time, they just give up and say what's easiest, most effective for something like yes. And the problem is really that they don't. It's probably very difficult to get them to really understand what's about. Someone going to this application wants to get to the network and. Why should I wish it? Why should it? And why shouldn't it?
Yeah.
And if you can answer whether this application, if you can document why this application should go on the network, you probably actually can build a policy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you shouldn't be tasked with at that point.
Yeah.
Well, I think there are two distinct use cases. The one is yes, I know the time is up. One thing is you want to secure your general work to. Workflow, your day-to-day applications, that you probably don't need these interactive pop-ups to asking you what to do. But I think there's also another use case where you are running a potentially untrusted application, you want to supervise it. And therefore these pop-ups can be very useful if you actively want to supervise them.
Sort of training programs you run it the first few times maybe, and you're seeing what it's doing. But whether you end user really wants to be doing that.
End user might, in the Windows world, end user might they get into the conference, maybe not .conf, but some other very interesting conference, and they're being given a USB key with some stuff on it, and of course it's something they have to learn, because that's how it's done in Windows world, and so they plug in the software, and if they've been sensibilized, they might want to say, I have to run the software, but I want to run it as being insecure, and then have those kind of pop-up you're talking about, and this would be interesting.
That would probably more apply to software that you're downloading and installing yourself rather than system installed software, but presumably that should be tested.
Yes, maybe.
But not always, of course.
Not always, but I think that's
a good point. It's a more likely situation.
And you have to admit that's a common use case nowadays. More idea, more inputs? Time is up.
Time out.
Well, thanks you for attending the session. I think we have written down some interesting points. Stefan, are we allowed to say what we are doing?
We are writing trojans to get past all the stuff?
No, the website is supposed to go online, so
yeah,
we are working.
We're working on such a project to get some environment that end user can have
we are currently evaluating different security frameworks and want to hear from you some requirements or common use cases, which I think we have written down some interesting points here to make a centralized approach like you are demanding. I think we can call the name, it will be the Anubis project. Website is going to be online soon. We actually want to work in that direction.
For those kind of interesting applications or interesting things.
Yes.
It's big to have.
Well, thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for operating the camera. I like the name.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Filmstar 19. He wants to just say that the ISO 9006 is.